Hi, everyone. We are so excited that you decided to attend Sunday service today.
We only have about 3 minutes left until service.
Month, we will have lots of activities to attend, so make sure you mark your calendars and invite your friends and family so that no one misses out.
We're excited to share with you that the Freedom Center is officially open. It will have counseling rooms dedicated to helping you find freedom through Christ. Please check out our new website for more information.
We have our night of prayer on the first Wednesday of every month. We would love for you to attend so that we can all pray together and grow closer to God.
We also have Starting Point every month. If you would love to get involved through serving here at Crosspoint, you need to attend a Starting Point class. These classes will help you get plugged in to the right place for you to serve here. If you are new here, we also have an event called Pizza with Pastor, where you can meet our pastor and get to know more about our church. So check out our website for dates and details on that.
Did you know that Crosspoint has released an EP? That's right. We have 6 songs available on Spotify, Apple Music, and iTunes. These songs are written by different people here in the church. We would love for you to click on the QR code on the screen and check it out.
Next, our youth group. Our students grow closer to God every week in a safe environment with food, fellowship, worship, messages, community, and lots of fun. We would love for your teenager to join us.
On top of this, we also have community groups which meet at various times throughout the month. We want to make sure that you are getting connected with the community so that your faith can grow in a positive environment.
Hey, are you interested in furthering your education? Well, Crosspoint Church has partnered with Southeastern University in Florida to provide college classes here at our church. These classes are fully accredited as well as offer the benefit of an internship. If you are in any way interested, please check out our events page on our website for more information.
On Wednesday, November the 29th, we will be hosting our Discipleship 201 class. If you have already attended a Discipleship 101 class, come join us in this wonderful opportunity to learn how to become a disciple of Christ. Please check online for dates and details at cptyler.church.
Lastly, Friday, November 17th, we will be hosting our Men's Summit. Make sure to invite your friends, your brothers, fathers, grandfathers, sons, grandsons, and husbands for this night with lots of food, big giveaways, and most importantly, encountering the presence of our living God together.
This is all the announcements we have for this month. First time check-in that we would love for you to check out.
All right, that's it for the announcements. Hurry up, there's only 30 seconds left on the timer and you do not want to miss worship. We hope you enjoy our service today.
Prophesy. But we also ask that you show us places in our hearts that may not align to that. There is truly nothing better than the presence of God, but there are things in our lives often that we don't even realize are standing in the way of more. Idols or altars that have been there for so long that they feel comfortable. They feel normal. They feel like they belong, but they don't. And they are holding us back. And the enemy tries to convince us that they keep us safe. But they do not keep you safe. They keep you from greater revelation and greater experience in the presence of the Lord. So I challenge you today to ask the Holy Spirit to evaluate your heart, to show you places that are still hidden from Him, places that need the light of the love of Jesus to shine into them and expose everything that doesn't belong, so we can worship Him in spirit and in truth, because He loves you. Do you know how loved you are? Worship Him because of how much He loves you and how much He cares for you.
This means
to your knees. Just drop to your knees and tell him you just need him. He's waiting. He loves you so much and he wants to give you all of himself. He wants to give you so much more. Surrender. Lay it down.
I'm Jesus' name. We pray for revival. We pray for healing. We pray for restoration. We pray for breakthrough. We pray for the healing over diseases. We pray for the healing of minds and spirits. We pray. And not only do we pray, we believe. We believe. And we command that the plans and the schemes and the illnesses and the diseases of the enemy must flee and go in Jesus' name. We claim this. In just a moment, I don't want to leave this moment right now. I just believe that God wants to do something special, but I'm just going to ask you to just ask the Holy Spirit, what inside of me needs a breakthrough right now? What inside of me needs to see the King on the throne right now? What inside of me? What is blocking? What is trying to stop me? I come against any spirit of religion, apathy, unbelief, doubt. And I claim the miracle of Christ upon every person in this room and who's watching online. We're not here for show. We're here because we love you, Lord. We're here to be in your presence. So I'm going to ask us, I want to sing that again. And I want us to proclaim those things. Whatever it is, we're going to proclaim life to our hearts, life to our situation. We're going to proclaim breakthrough to our health. Breakthrough in Jesus' name. So I just want you to just, where you're at, whether you can get on your knees or whatever it is, let's just lift our hands. Let's break through right now. Right now, let's just take a moment. It's gonna change. There's no other name.
can heal that disease. I know that you can free me from this anxiety. I know that you can free me from this depression. I know that you can. And when people say that you can't, watch him. Watch him. My God will. Your God will. He has never failed. He didn't fail then. He's not going to fail you today. He's not going to fail you tomorrow. And he sure won't fail you ever.
Yeah. Yeah. For those of you that may not understand what we just did, there was a lot of spiritual warfare that just took place. And with spiritual warfare comes spiritual breakthrough. And when you have spiritual breakthrough, then you have spiritual victory. Because Jesus only knows victory. And so we're going to celebrate in victory. And we're going to celebrate by taking communion together. I know it's all of you guys are down here, but we got to make room for some communion here. It's coming. This is another way to celebrate. He is thick in the room. You just let her do what God wants to do. Let God do what he wants to do. But this morning, we're going to take communion together. You're going to receive two elements. You're going to exit to your left, go back to the right, one row at a time. You do not have to be a member of the church to take communion. You just be a member of the kingdom. And if you don't know who this Jesus is that has already been doing miracles this morning, we'd love to introduce you to him. Find one of us, staff, or just bump the person next to you. It's a good bet that they will want to help lead you and guide you to the throne room of Jesus this morning. But we're going to take communion. We're going to celebrate. Ladies and gentlemen, we get to celebrate. Look what God has already been doing this morning. We're going to get to exalt to the name of Jesus, exalt to the Lord what he's done and what he did so long ago so that we could do what we're doing right now. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. And we'll release you to come and get your elements, and then we're going to continue to go back, worship, and we'll take communion together.
Name above all names, we worship you today.
Angels up in heaven.
power to our God who is holy. The angels in heaven, creation on earth shall declare in the, come on, sing it with me. Your glory forever. You're worthy of honor.
Jesus, because of what he did, he laid his body down for us, and he gave of himself. The word says that he was unrecognizable as a man, and he did it because he had victory in store for you. So we celebrate you, Lord Jesus. And we come with you with thankful hearts, with reverent hearts, with hearts that know that no matter what comes against us, because of what you did on that cross, we stand in victory. And we thank you. So let us take the bread in celebration of what he's done. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for the blood that you shed. I know some people may think, why are you celebrating? This is just supposed to be reverence and soft, but you gave all of your blood so that we could be washed white as snow, and I'm celebrating that. I'm thankful that I don't have to carry generations of pain. I'm thankful that I don't have to carry my own. Because you've made me clean. And you continue to do so. I thank you that your blood never loses power. And you didn't think twice about giving it. You gave it all. So we praise your name. And we thank you. And we exalt the Lord. We exalt King Jesus. Let us take the juice in remembrance of the blood shed. We praise you, Lord. Can we just give him a shout offering and just thank him for what he's done this morning? Hallelujah! Come on. Man, he's good. It's great to have fun in church. It's great to have breakthrough in church. Amen? Awesome. Well, let's take just a quick moment. Greet the person next to you. Let them know I'm free today.
The word of God tells us I was glad when they told me to come into the house of the Lord. Are you glad this morning? I think this group right here is. Woo, yes. Woo, I don't know about you, but we like to have fun. I mean, we're coming to celebrate the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, right? So there's nothing better to get pumped up and excited about. And so we're going to do that here today at Crosspoint. So if you are new and this is your first time and maybe this is a little new to you, but we're just, again, we're celebrating the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we're going to get excited about that, and we are not ashamed of doing that this morning today. So, but if you are new, we want to welcome you, and we want to thank you for being with us. If you are new and you're watching us online today, we want to say welcome. We are glad that you joined us, and we are so glad you chose Crosspoint as your place to worship the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so this is, we are thrilled that you are here. If you are new and you haven't yet already stopped by the Welcome Center, we'd love for you to do that. You can do that on your way out. We have a gift that we would love to give you, and we want to get to know you a little bit better. We would love to connect with you and just again say welcome, and we'd love to have you be a part of this church. So one of the things we have going on, if you are new, is we have what's called Pizza with Pastor. And so this is actually happening next Sunday after the second service, after this service. We'll do that next door in the Student Life Center. We will provide you with the best pizza in town, and we will answer any question that you might have. Pastor Jonathan will be there. This is a great opportunity, again, if you are new to Crosspoint, new to this church, to come learn a little bit more about who we are as a church, what we believe, what our values are, get to know a little bit more about us, and ask Pastor any question. Last week, we had a child ask Pastor, where do babies come from? So, you know, nothing's off limits. Now, he did deflect that one pretty good. He said, ask your mother. So, believe me, it's a great time to come learn a little bit more about us. We'd love for you to come and do that. It's right after second service next week. Next door in the Student Life Center. One of the things you haven't noticed is our youth group down here. Woo, yeah. They're a little excited. They've been on a youth retreat. They've been, 48, 72 hours without sleep. They're pumped up on Red Bull this morning. They're ready to go. Now, they are an amazing group. And if you are here and you're a teenager, you're not over here, you need to be a part of this group. And if you are a parent of a teenager that is not in the youth group, I really suggest and highly recommend that you get them involved. They normally meet on Sunday evenings from 5 to 7. Tonight, they're taking it off because they've been 72 hours without sleep. So they're going to take tonight off. They had an amazing week. I've heard some stories. There are just some breakthroughs that have happened. It's been an awesome time, so they're excited this morning. But if you are, again, if you are a parent of a teenager, we highly recommend you get them involved. They normally meet on Sundays. They'll meet next Sunday evening from 5 to 7 p.m. All right, maybe you've noticed this in my hand, and maybe you guys sat on one of those this morning, or maybe you're still sitting on it and you're a little uncomfortable. But these are our Thanksgiving, our Project Reach Thanksgiving giveaway. And what we would like for you guys to do is take this bag out this week, fill it up with the items on the list. You don't have to fill up exactly what's on there, but you can pretty much follow that. Gives you an idea of what we would like to give. And we are, as a church, we're providing the turkeys, and we're going to provide turkeys for 150 families this year. And so, yes. So that's awesome. So during this week, fill these up, bring them back next Sunday, and we'll have them out front. But then that following Saturday, we will be going out and distributing these into the community. If you'd like to be a part of that, you can register online and go online. Say, you know what, I want to help distribute these out into the community. We'll be doing that again a week from Saturday. And so it's an awesome time for you to get involved in helping out and helping some people out. So we really want to fill these up. We want to see this room packed out with bags this next Sunday. So take these, fill them up this week, and then bring them back next Sunday, all right? All right, I'm going to pray, and then we've got a video that we're going to show as well. So God, we just come before you this morning. Lord, you're so good. I loved coming in here, Lord God, and just getting excited to be in your presence, God. Just that's enough, because you loved us so much, and you cared for us so much, Lord God. We thank you, God. And so, Lord, be with us today, Lord God. Continue your Holy Spirit just to speak to our hearts this morning. Lord, I pray that through the words that Pastor speaks this morning, that people's lives will be changed, Lord God. There'll be breakthrough. There'll be transformation, God. And, Lord, we just pray that your Spirit continues to move amongst us. Lord, help our hearts to be fertile soil so they can land and it can grow. And, Lord God, it can produce a harvest 10 to 100 times, Lord God, what you planted. And so, God, would just be with us today. We want to give you praise because you are worthy of all praise. And so, Lord, we just lift you up on high this morning. And we say these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, let's watch this video.
Fun weekend, awesome night, and we got all the stains almost out of the carpet. It was amazing. It was awesome. Well, we are so glad that you are here this morning. Everybody doing well? Man, that was, worship was just powerful. That was some intense. It was great stuff. I just love being in his presence, amen? Nothing like it. So, well, we got some business to do, and then we are So we're going to do a couple things here. We're going to, number one, we're going to pray over Israel. And then we're going to get deep and pray in Israel. Then we're going to get, have you sit down. Then we're going to have the babies come up and the cuteness factor will rise. It won't just be me. The cuteness factor will elevate. And so then you'll get to stand and we'll get to sit back again. So it's going to feel like Baptist church hymnals, okay? So, but we need to continue praying for Israel. It's important for us to pray for Israel. And so I'm going to ask us to go ahead and start, and let's go ahead and stand and pray over Israel. I want to read to you from Psalm 48, 2-3, and it says, "It is high and magnificent. The whole earth rejoices to see it. Mount Zion, the holy mountain, is in the city of the great king. God himself is in Jerusalem's towers, revealing himself as its defender." He is our defender. He is Israel's defender. He has been and always will be. And so we're going to just pray over Israel right now. Lord God, we come before you and we pray for our brothers and sisters in Israel. Lord, we pray for the protection of Israel. We pray for the protection of Jerusalem. We pray for the peace of Israel, Lord God. And Lord, we just pray right now that we know that there are rockets being fired. We know that there are man-made destructive devices that are being aimed at Israel. And we know that they have their own devices to protect. But, Lord, there is no greater protection than your arms. And we ask that you would just wrap your arms around Israel right now, Lord. And, Lord, I just pray right now that those that are against Israel, Lord, that you would begin to change their hearts. Lord, we're not praying that they are defeated in death. We are praying that they come to life in you. We are praying, Lord, that the missionaries that have been there, that the gospel that has been preached, Lord, in the streets there, Lord, would begin to take effect over the hatred and over the violence. Lord, that they would begin to see the grace and love of Jesus. Lord, we ask that you just begin to appear before them and change their hearts, that they would have Saul-like encounters. Lord God, what greater testimony would there be if a whole nation decided we are going to stop the war because we fell in love with Jesus? And that's what we pray, Lord. But we do pray for your protection. We pray for the wisdom of those that are leading. Lord, give them wisdom and what to do. And Lord, use this time to wake all of us up. To wake us up into the supernatural and to see what you're doing. Lord, we claim your protection. We claim your protection over all the Jewish people here in the States and around the world. And Lord, we give all glory to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, you can be seated before you have to stand again. Woo! Get your physical exercise in at Cross Point this morning. So, this is the fun stuff. The cuteness factor is about to take place. So, we're going to ask for John and Summer Boyd to bring up Myla Valerie Boyd and Jackson Braden Dorsey. We're going to ask for Brooke to bring up Grayson Hunter Eckerman. It just has your name, Leanna. It doesn't have your husband's name on here, but I guess she's just typed that in. So we'll accept your whole family. Come on up. Bring up little Nash. Nash Owen. All right. And then we're going to ask Alan Wood and Lauren to bring Phoenix Elizabeth Wood. Where are they? There they are. Oh, there it goes. Honey's coming. All right. That's the grandma name. Awesome. Well, I told you the cuteness factor was coming up. It is awesome. We are so honored and privileged to be able to pray over you and your child, your children. And what an honor it is to be able to do this. And we want you to know that we understand that as parents, this is not an easy thing. Parenting is hard. But with the wisdom of God, you will make every step and he will be with you every step of the way. And one of the things that we get to do is, as children of God, when he says, I'm going to give you children, we get to hand them back and say, Lord, do with them as you will. And we believe that each child that is on this stage has a purpose and is valued by God, and God has a certain plan for each one. And he's going to use each one of your kids in Jesus' name, even if they try to run away. But we're going to pray. We're going to anoint you with oil, each child with oil. And we are going to just pray over each one in Jesus' mighty name. So we are going to ask once again if we would stand and pray. If you would join us. He did not like the stage. All right. So we're just going to anoint each one. Lord Jesus, we just come before you and we just say thank you. Thank you for each child. Thank you for the destiny that you have for each one of them. Thank you that each one of these children have a plan and a purpose for you, that they're going to be impactors for your kingdom. Lord, we thank you that these children are not here by chance, that you have a direct purpose for each one of them. You have a plan laid out for them to grow in you and grow your kingdom. I speak leadership over them. I speak your prophetic word over them, that they would prophesy, that they would be encouragers to those around them. I ask that they would lead, that they would all be leaders to those around them, Lord God, that people would just naturally would be drawn to each one of them as they grow. And Lord, I just speak your protection over them. I speak life over each one of them. I ask that they would grow up and they would just know your word and know you, though they would never turn to the right or to the left, but they would just stay on straight path with you, Lord God. And even when the enemy tries to come at them with doubt, they would lean on you and they would lean on their parents, Lord God. I ask that the bond between them and parents is strong. And they would grow together, Lord God. Lord, we speak your truth over them. We speak your life over them. And Lord, we just speak your anointing and your blessings and your favor on them. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. So we have some gifts. I got some lovely assistants that are coming out, and they have some gifts for you. There is a Bible for each one of your kids. There is a Bible, and there is a little booklet for you and a couple other things. And then there is a letter from me, so when they turn 13, they get to read that letter. So the deal is, don't go home, steam the envelope open, and read the letter. It is for them when they turn 13, and it is to encourage them, because we know things change at 13 years old, and life gets a little trickier. So I want words to encourage them and build them up. So we love you guys. And may the blessings of the Lord be on you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank y'all so much. I love getting to do that. That's one of the perks of the job. I love it. All right. Well, y'all ready to jump in this? We are going to jump into the Word, and we are going to continue our series entitled Moral Chaos. Moral Chaos. And I don't know if you've noticed, but that's where the world is right now. We are in a state of moral chaos. You just think, well, it's just in chaos. It's in chaos because we don't understand the morals and we're not standing on the morals that have been set before us. And so that's why we're in such chaos right now. We have forgotten the foundation on which we're supposed to be standing, and the foundation of the Lord. And we've got to get back into the foundation of the Lord. And we as believers, it is our job to not just be quiet about it, but to tell people, to be active on it. And we've been quiet as the church for too long. We've been too compliant for too long. We've decided we're going to just be nice for too long. And in our niceness, the enemy has come in. And it's time for us to step up. It's time for teenagers to step up. It's not just the responsibility of the adults. It's the responsibility of our teenagers. And I don't know about you, but our young people, have you ever had your child speak truth into your life? It happens. It happens. And they can speak truth real easily. But we have to be, we've got to be a church that speaks life into every situation. And we've got to be a church that knows what we stand on our morality, and where that comes from. And we are in a battle, and it's not just a cultural battle. It's not a cultural war. It is a war between false gods trying to take away the living God in our lives. The thing is, the living God stays living. And he will never be defeated. He can never be defeated. He is the true God. But the false promises of man will lead to destruction. God's way leads to life. And it is our responsibility to stand up for the gospel of Jesus. I love what Tozer says. We used this a couple weeks ago, but I think we need to repeat it. He says, too often, not wanting to offend anyone, we end up reaching no one. We got to stop being scared of offending people with the truth of the gospel. We need to give the gospel in love, and we need to give it in grace. But we don't need to back down. We've backed down long enough. We've been scared to offend, and then we've taken sides. We're like, well, I'll give my biblical point, but then I'll give my political point. Well, your biblical point should feed into your political point. 100%. Right and wrong have become blurry where they don't need to be blurry. And I don't know if you've ever been to the optometrist, but you know they put that thing on your face that's like in your space. And it's that big thing, and they sit there and they go, okay, do you see better with one or two? Two or three? Two or four? Three or 45? And then there's that point where they kind of look kind of similar, and you get stuck, and you're like, I don't know. And you're like, I don't even want to answer the question. I didn't study. But then after all you got through all their stuff, you're like, actually, I liked one. One was pretty good. I should have stuck with that. I've been here for 2 hours. I'm here to say maybe we need to get back to vision number one. And we need to start looking at everything that we're going through and everything in this life through vision number one, and that's through God's eyes. Maybe we don't need to look at things like the Israelites did and look at things through their compromised lens. And they began to look at things through compromised lenses and eyes because things became more convenient in their life. And it became more convenient to accept the idols of the nations around them than to stand for the righteousness of God. And I don't know about you, but how many of us feel like we're kind of surrounded by the Midianites and the Amalekites and the Philistines and all the other ites, and they're just kind of surrounding us, and we feel a little trapped right now. Maybe I need to clarify that. Maybe you feel a little trapped by the bills and life situations, and maybe the family that disagrees with you, or the job that you didn't really want, but you have, but God's put you there for a reason, but you still haven't accepted it. Maybe we need to start looking at things through God's eyes and how He's going to use us. Because no matter what's going on in your life, if God's anointing is on you, there can still be peace. If you have God's anointing, if you have His favor, if you have His blessing, you're going to get His peace. Judges 6:24 says, and Gideon built an altar. Remember we talked about Gideon last week. And it says, Gideon built an altar to the Lord there and named it Yahweh Shalom, which means the Lord is peace. He's peace. So what altar have we allowed to be built up inside? Is it an altar of panic? Or is it an altar of peace? Is it an altar of anger? An altar of peace. What have we allowed to be built up inside of us? And let me tell you, when you have God's anointing and favor and blessing, everything you do, God's in it. And God is with you. And God is for you. Even though everything else is against you, God is still with you. And we can't surrender to the culture, to the religious, and to the woke, and to the gods of this age. We can't do it. There is a spirit of this age. It is a demonic, deceptive spirit that is going against the Holy Spirit. And we need to decide what we are building the altars of our hearts to. Our key scripture is Jeremiah 6:16 through 17. And it says this. This is what the Lord says. Stop at the crossroads and look around. Ask for the old godly way and walk in it. Travel its path and you will find rest for your souls. But you will reply, no, that's not the road we want. I posted watchmen over you who said, listen for the sound of the alarm. But you replied, no, we won't pay attention. When we become stubborn and we start putting those things up, we are building altars, not just to ourselves, but to a spirit of defiance. And when you're at that crossroad, you need to recognize what altar we're building in our hearts. Now, let me remind you what an altar is. The altar is a raised structure or place on which worship is offered, a sacred place. So are we going to worship deception? Are we going to worship culture? Or are we going to worship the Lord? What are we building? What's on the altar of our hearts? Let me ask you this. What have we been sacrificing to? Because a sacrifice is placed on an altar. So what are we sacrificing to? Because I bet that's where the battle begins. And we're going to broach a subject this morning that I just want you to understand. I am not here to bring shame, judgment, condemnation on anybody for your thought patterns or maybe something that you have done in the past. But I'm here to expose some things and to bring some revelation to what we are actually doing biblically and spiritually so that you can become free. And for you to have knowledge to take to someone else. If you don't know this already. Because what we have done in our compliance, we have bowed and built up the altars to convenience. And we have an altar to convenience that we have built up inside of us. And let's be very honest. We like convenient things, don't we? We like it when things are convenient to us, right? We do all of our birthday, graduation, holiday, Christmas shopping online because it's convenient, right? We go out to eat or we settle for drive-through because it's convenient for us, right? We do our grocery shopping online and have them bring it out to us because it's, right? Bucky's has everything that you could ever want in one store. And we go to Bucky's, we make special stops there because it's convenient. We all order from Amazon for the convenience, but we tend to get upset on the delivery. Like literally this past week, I made a food decision because I was like, ooh, I really want this, but I decided not to go there because I didn't want to get out of my truck. And so I went through the drive-thru of another place that was not as good, not as healthy, but I went there because it was more convenient. Anybody ever do that before? I made that food decision. Well, a lot of people make other decisions, like maybe they got together with the person that they loved and they decided to have sex and the lady got pregnant. And instead of having the baby, it was more convenient to abort. I told you it was going to be touchy. It's going to mess with some people. But if we don't talk about it in the church, your junior high kids are already hearing about it and being indoctrinated. We have to address this. But once again, we're going to address the spiritual because the spiritual part of this goes to the biblical part. And then the biblical part is going to influence us politically. It could change us for generations if we do the right thing. But a lot of times we base our life decisions on what's convenient for us. And we're bowing to the altar of convenience. And we've got to stop. I'm pretty sure that throughout this entire book that I have read, it was very rare that God just made things convenient for people, for the heroes of the Bible. I'm pretty sure it wasn't very convenient when Elijah took off and he had to be fed by ravens. You're like, well, that sounds pretty convenient, except he was starving until the ravens brought him food. And it's not like it was a hamburger. They can only carry so much. You ever think about that? That boy went hungry. I'm not here to put people down. I'm here to bring spiritual revelation that will affect your natural response. Jeremiah is pleading with the nation. He's pleading with Israel to turn back to God. And he is broken because Israel has turned back to idols and they've built up so many altars to all these false idols that they don't even know what they stand for anymore. And they don't realize that all of these altars that they've built up in their heart are bowing to the altar of Baal. Because it has one source. And the altar of Baal is a reflection of the devil. And Jeremiah is saying, stop worshiping there. And it progressed from Baal to Ishtar to Molech. And we're going to talk about those this morning in the 16 minutes we have left. Well, here's the deal. A lot of our generation, a lot of generations before us have started bowing to a god in abortion that they didn't even realize. They just thought they were doing a natural thing, but they don't even realize that they're sacrificing their babies to the god of Molech. I'm going to read to you from Jeremiah 19, 4 through 6. And then we're going to dive into that a little bit. Jeremiah 19, 4 through 6 says, "For Israel has forsaken me and turned this valley into a place of wickedness. The people burn incense to foreign gods, idols never before acknowledged by this generation, by their ancestors or by the kings of Judah. And they have filled this place with the blood of innocent children. They have built pagan shrines to Baal, and there they burn their sons as sacrifices to Baal. I have never commanded such a horrible deed. It never even crossed my mind to command such a thing. So beware, for the time is coming, says the Lord, when this garbage dump will no longer be called Topheth or the Valley of Ben-Hinnom, but the Valley of Slaughter." Let's talk about Molech right now, because Molech is all about the devaluation of human life. And Molech is a destroyer god. He has the head of a bull and the body of a human being. He was the god of the Amorites, and the Jews had chosen to adopt Baal, and they're going to try to worship Yahweh and Baal, which doesn't work. Then they're going to go to Ishtar. Ishtar is the goddess of the sexual revolution. Anybody heard those terms before? It's the same spirit that is attacking us today. And then they go from Ishtar to Molech, the destroyer. Because what happens now? The world is serving the god of whatever, evolution. Well, I'm going to just throw that one in there. Which says that you're a mistake. You're just lucky to be here. You made it here by chance. You are just a piece of goo that just got here. And then we get up and we start worshiping ourselves, which is basically the worship of Baal. Then we go to Ishtar because we want to be free sexually. Woohoo! Because we don't want consequences. So let's just kill the consequences out of us. Right? I know I'm hitting heavy. And then we're going to take those consequences. We're going to sacrifice them to the god of Molech. In the culture, it's not seen that way. Spiritually, that's what's happening. And the Jews had adopted this. And here's the other thing about Ishtar. Ishtar was against, wanted to destroy fatherhood, emasculate men. We're going to talk more about that next week. You all are so ready. There's going to be like five people here. Pastor Steph is here. We're going to talk about a little bit about that next week. I want to destroy fatherhood. Also want to destroy motherhood. That's what she wants to do. Molech was seated when they built their gods. Molech, the head of the bull, body of a human, is seated with palms up. And the belly is hollowed out for the fire, and that's where they would place the babies in. They would place their babies in there, and they would make their sacrifices to the god of Molech so that they would have provisions. It was all about provisions. It was all about me. It was all about self. What is abortion all about today? It's the same thing. Well, if I have this baby, it's going to affect my future. Here's another similarity. Here's what else happened. and this is happening all around the world. It doesn't happen as much as in America yet, but it is happening. Actually, I take it back. It is happening because a lot of doctors will say, this is what's going on with your baby. You need to abort it. But it was a lot of infants with deformities or disabilities were commonly discarded by their parents, left in garbage dumps, drowned in rivers, exposed to the elements, or abandoned to wild animals. They would just be thrown away. That is another thing that is happening today with aborted babies. Oh, your baby has a little bit of problems with it. You probably need to abort. It's the same thing that's being done today. You need to throw it away. Wait for one that's perfect. I don't know about you, but I have seen so many young people come out that are, we call them special needs, but they teach us so much. Amen. And they love so great. They are a blessing, not a curse. Now let's talk about the Valley of Ben-Hinnom real quick. The Hebrew word there is topheth, and the root word is toph, which means drums. And what they would do is they would play drums loudly to drown out the screams of the children being sacrificed. And they would play the drums loud. The more babies were thrown in, the more they would scream, as many as they could, because it wasn't just a little statue. It was big, and they made multiple. And so they were throwing them all in there, sacrificing their babies for provision and worship of Molech. And they would say, I don't want to hear them scream, so drum louder. Play the music louder. Play the music louder. Drum louder. Do it louder. We do the same thing today. You ever watch the lines, the people that are chanting? They don't want to hear what they've done. They want to hear my body, my choice. And they want to chant it loud. And let me tell you, they get pretty angry. It's amazing if you watch how angry these protesters who want you to be tolerant are not tolerant of your beliefs. Because we're worshiping the God of Molech. They just don't know. We've got to tell them. Once again, I'm not here to judge anybody because there's freedom here today. God will heal you today. There's hope here today. You know that there are bills trying to be passed in America and all over the world to abort babies that are 28 days after birth? They're trying to be passed right now. You're not going to hear about them because they want them passed. They don't want the public to know. Ladies and gentlemen, we're supposed to be a people, a nation, a Christian church under the shadow of the Almighty, not the shadow of Molech. Jonathan Cahn, who is a author, theologian, pastor, man of God, he has this quote, and he says this: female celebrities, feminist leaders, and other women of influence would publicly boast that they were able to find success in their careers because they ended the lives of their unborn children. Thus, the reason given was in essence the same as that which led the ancient mothers to lift their children into Moloch's altars. And by doing so, they believed they were invoking blessing, prosperity, and gain. This is a man who's researched this. He understands this. Proverbs 6:16 says, there are six things that the Lord hates. No, seven things he detests: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that kill the innocent. I want you to understand this. Crosspoint Church is a place of grace to those who have had abortions, to the men who have been a party to it, I want you to know that we love you. Jesus loves you. He still sent his son to die for you, and he rose for you, and his blood will still wash you white as snow. And there, we have talked to so many people that have been through this process. I am not here to judge you. I want you free, and I want you filled back up with the Holy Spirit. I want you made whole. But if we don't talk about this stuff, then we're going to be doomed to repeat it in the generations under us. And then we have to stand before Lord God Almighty and answer for it. But we've got to talk about this. So, okay, so you've taken that. Now let's take a breath. All right. And let's talk about the good altars, like the altar of the potter. Because if you go one chapter before, in chapter 18, 1 through 6, this is what it says. The Lord gave another message to Jeremiah. He said, go down to the potter's shop, and I will speak to you there. So I did as he told me and found the potter working at his wheel. But the jar he was making did not turn out as he had hoped. So he crushed it into a lump of clay again and started over. Then the Lord gave me this message. O Israel, can I not do to you as this potter has done to his clay? As the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand. Here's what's awesome. You're not a mistake. Life is not an accident. God's hands are on you. You are a child of God, and he is here to help shape you and mold you and help you in every way that you need help. Jeremiah 1:5 says, I knew you before you were born. I formed you in your mother's womb. Before you were born, I set you apart and appointed you as my prophet to the nations. Ladies and gentlemen, number one, we are all the design of the potter. And we need to understand that. Number two, we are all marred, but we're not abandoned by the potter. Every one of us has sin in our life. We've all messed up. We've all screwed up. We've all got some damage. And I don't know if you've ever had a potter's wheel before you and you tried to take some clay and turn it into something amazing. I tried that in like junior high. Total failure. It's hideous. It's horrible. Like, I was trying to make pots, and I just got to where I would just put the thing on there and make it spin as fast as it can and see how long it took to shoot off. And I would count my distance. I was like, I could roll balls really well. That's about as long. But when I tried to actually make stuff out of it, and it was horrible. But you know what? I took those things home after we fired them and put them through the kiln, and my mom still has those things. I'm like, these are horrible, but she loves them. Doesn't matter how cracked, how messed up they are, mom still loves them. Doesn't matter how cracked, how messed up you are, God still loves you. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if you got some stuff in there that wasn't supposed to be in there. He can shape it. He can take it out. He can mold it. He can put new clay in. That's what he does. And when the pressure comes, he uses it to shape our morality and confirm the values that we live by. Number three, we are all valuable in the eyes of the potter. We're all valuable. And a lot of times we kind of dismiss how much God loves us and how much he values us, especially when we have some bad days or weeks. But don't be afraid of the pressure moments, because that's God just taking care of you. That's God just shaping you. That's God making something beautiful that maybe other people don't see, but he sees. And he's not going to forget. He'll never forget you. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are God's what? Okay, don't Christianize it. Don't make it religious. Speak from the heart. For we are God's. Okay, you almost got there. But with a little bit more excitement, just like I remind my wife all the time when I read her this scripture, I am God's masterpiece. Look what you got. Okay? So let's believe it when we say it again. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. You are his masterpiece. Don't forget that. Hold on to it. You bear the signature of your creator. You are made in the image and likeness of your creator. You are of great value and worth. And to prove how valuable you are, he sent his son for you because he knew we were gonna make mistakes. He knew that his people were gonna listen to culture. He knew that we were gonna bow to the altar of convenience. He knew that abortions were gonna happen. He knew that men and women were gonna be a part of that. But he also knew that he has a son that can redeem it all, and he can restore everything, and he can fill you back up with hope and life and make sure that he is your provider instead of the God of Molech. Because the God of Molech is just a lie. Here's the truth. The truth is it was what Abraham did. He trusted a God who said, take your son, your only son, and take him up to the mountain and put him on the altar and sacrifice him. And Abraham didn't wait. It said the very next morning he went. Why did he do it the very next morning? Because he didn't want to tell wife, because she would not have it. So he went the very next morning and he left, took his servants, went up the mountain, made an altar. Son, Isaac's like, where's the provision? Where's the sacrifice? God will provide. He laid his son on the altar. Son going, this isn't what I thought. Tears flowing down Abraham's eyes. Because can you imagine having to put your child up there? And but before blood was shed, the angel stopped him. It says, at that moment, the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven, Abraham, Abraham. Yes, Abraham replied, here am I. Don't lay a hand on the boy. The angel said, do not hurt him in any way, for now I know that you truly fear God. You have not withheld from me even your son, your only son. Then Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught by its horns in a thicket. So he took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering in place of his son. Abraham named the place Jehovah Jireh, which means the Lord will provide. And to this day, people still use that name as a proverb. On the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided. And then when you go down later in verse 18, it says, all because you have obeyed me. Ladies and gentlemen, he's our provider. Whatever pressure you're at, he's the provider. And he's faithful to provide. Our faithfulness comes in obedience. How are we going to obey? Are we going to sacrifice our heart and our lives to the gods of Baal, Ishtar, and Molech? Or are we going to build up altars in our heart and say, no, 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 I'm going to trust my provider. No, 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 I'm going to trust the one who gave me life. I'm going to trust the one who's never failed me. I'm going to trust the one that said, I'm not a mistake, that I am a masterpiece. I'm going to trust the one who's never going to let me go. I'm not going to bow to the altar of convenience. I'm going to push through. Some of you just need to push through. Wherever you're going through, whatever you're at, you need to push through. Go through the valley of the shadow of death. It can be scary, but he's with you. And he will get you to the other side. Don't bow to the altar of convenience. It's time to build up the altar of Jehovah Jireh, your provider. I'm going to ask us to stand this morning. Let's stand together. And some of you have been feeling a lot of pressure. Maybe some of you have been a part of, maybe you've had an abortion. Maybe you've been the guy that's pushed for the abortion. Maybe that has just haunted you. Let me tell you, let's get free this morning. God's a God of freedom. He's here to free you this morning. Maybe the pressures of life are making you bow to the altar of convenience in your life, and you're just doing whatever is convenient, and it's been hard to push through lately. Maybe you just need to come up for prayer for that. But I'm going to have our ministry team come up and to get positioned. And let me tell you, these people are here to care for you. They're here to love you. They're here to stand with you. They're here to encourage you. They're here to help you push through. Nobody's here to judge. And I know that there are ladies in this room right now that God has forgiven them of abortions. And if you need someone to talk to, we'll hook you up with someone. We will help you. Because God has created you, and you're valuable to him. And he wants freedom for you. So come, Holy Spirit. Fill us anew. Speak to us right now. Come, Holy Spirit. Come. If you need prayer, come on up. Don't hesitate. Don't wait. Let's come get prayer, and let's continue to worship God right now. Come, Holy Spirit. Here we go.
Yeah. Father God, we just come this morning, Lord God, and we say that you are Lord of our lives. We choose, Lord God, to set you as the primary authority in our lives. And Lord, we thank you that you refuse to leave us, Lord God, where you find us, that you pick us up, Lord God, and you reshape us. And again, Lord God, you give us grace and mercy. God, we are so undeserving of all of your gifts. But Lord, you love us so much that you gave us the greatest gift. Lord, I pray that you would make us your light to a very broken and hurting world around us, Lord God. I pray that you would give us boldness to speak truth in love and grace, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you begin to turn the hearts of your sons and daughters.